just starting to pick up now.
I gave all the stuff to her because.
Oh my lordy!
You worried?
Okay.
You lose a turn.
Oh good.
Pay attention. That'll mess him up a bit. He's red. Now, if you hit that, yep, no, she hit the blue. It's red for the next turn.
Oh, okay.
But here it's very tricky because if you hit the yellow, it's a foul.
Right.
And you've got to hit the place. That's, you've done very well.
He was very well thought of by all the locals and, you know, we just wanted to be one of the boys, really, yes, which is a nice thing to remember him by, that everybody, nobody had a bad word to say about him. This is Alice's bedroom. Alice was Bill's sister. She was the eldest of the six children and Bill was the youngest. There was about 14 years difference. They lived here together from about 1939 until the late 60s when Alice passed away, and Bill passed away in 1970, about 18 months after her. So this is the original that we've got in the house. On the door here was it's actually the only original in the house. And Bill painted that for Alice after she'd said that he never did anything for her. So he came in and painted the door which led to the bathroom. So this is Bill's studio and these are his original art equipment and his easels. It was a lot messier than this though, I think, when Bill was painting. His hat. Yeah, his furniture and just a few photographs and memorabilia of Bill through his life. That's the photo over there of what the studio looked like. And the bed was part of the house too, but I don't know where he actually, I think he used that bed down in the sunroom more than up here. But. And he's actually painted this painting, or this one here, same, from the studio, which was the scene looking straight across the road. Yes, that was a little farmhouse that was straight across the road there. That John Russell came a few years ago and he donated a few bits and pieces, but he was visiting his relatives up the road and he came down and Bill said, oh, I want to paint you, and he did that portrait of him. He was about 14 at the time and entered in also in the Archibald Prize. It didn't win, but I think it's now down in the art gallery at Benalla in Victoria.
Is there any clue as to the reason he had this elongated style?
Yes.
A reason for that?
No. It started when he painted Joshua, who was his friend. They worked at Rathmines at the Catalina base doing camouflage painting in the war. And he said, I'm going to paint you like that. And Joshua was quite happy. But I think he must have just been sick of painting, you know.
Normal portrait or something.
Yeah, and thought, I'll try something else, yes. And then he continued on with, you know, the Strapper and Dame Mary Gilmore and, yes. When he when he lived in London, he painted, he said, you know, this reminded him of all the ladies that were standing around, you know, waiting outside Harrods, yes, with the, you know, they have a little fluffy dog under their arm and waiting for their chauffeur to come and get them. It's actually called Mrs. South Kensington. He painted looking out his, you know, to the lake from the front room there. He's watching the neighbours come in and retrieve their boat with the storm coming. Investiture, you know, when he was knighted, and his MBE, I don't know whether you, and he was knighted by Lord Casey. And after he was knighted, he's gone down to the pub at Wangi that night, and they've put the red carpet out for him, which is a bar mat. And he said, and they said to him, "You're just bloody old Bill to us. You're not going to be Sir William to us." This was actually like the front room. The door was there to come into the original little house, and then when it was all sealed off, it became, yeah, just a little room that his nephew said he sometimes slept here. He had a bit of a couch here, and this is also one of the places where he slept. And then they are his books.
The Workers Club is crowded with people looking at the photographic exhibition coordinated by John Frost. That's worth having a look at if you haven't been there yet. But there's plenty of room around here. 12 o'clock, the official opening and recognition of the centenary. The time capsules on display.
The ultimate ladies' lunch.
Memorabilia from this club, which has been in existence for many, many years. The police would be happy to give you a look at their RV vehicle, but no free rides. And we're asking anyone who wants to take the milk crate climbing challenge. 14 is the number we've got to. Any adults over the age of 8 are welcome to go and have a try at getting to 15 milk crates. That would be an enormous record. As well as that, there's a climbing wall, and the RSL have their own food stall. Is this silver object in front of us, the time capsule, which will hold a record of today's events and events earlier than that for somebody to marvel over in 100 years when it is reopened. It will be buried in front of Dobell House, and the satellite coordinates will be in the records of Lake Maquarie City Council, Lake Maquarie District Historical Society, and Dobell House itself. Any comments about what should go in there other than young children will be most welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, the official party. But firstly, I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet today and pay my respects to the elders, past and present. And now to welcome guests and sponsors. For every organisation such as this, there is somebody at the top, and the chair of the Wangi Centenary Organising Committee, Mr. Bruce McFarlane.
Thank you. Thank you, Murray. Of course, look, we're absolutely stoked at the response we've got, and this is just typical of Wangi and the people that have been here in the past and have come back, and it's wonderful support, and we thank everybody for coming along. It's been great. And but these events can't be put on without the sponsorship of the organisations locally. And so we particularly want to thank our major sponsors, which is the Workers Club, Origin Energy, and Centennial Coal, and also Lake Maquarie City Council, which all those people have been very generous sponsors, and we thank them very much for that. I've also been handed something that our local member Greg Piper will be saying a few words in a minute, but he told me that he has written, he made a speech in Parliament, and it's been obviously acknowledged in Hansard about Wangi and the centenary celebrations. And I might just read out an extract from his speech to Parliament House in Sydney.
Don't worry, it was a short speech.
Here we go. I pay tribute to the wonderful people of Wangi Wangi on the shores of Lake Maquarie, who will come together and celebrate the centenary of their town this weekend. Born as a picturesque lakeside holiday town, Wangi has a history that is almost as colourful as some of the characters who have lived there over the years. It was home to one of Australia's most celebrated artists in Sir William Dobell, whose house and gallery remain in place, cared for by a dedicated team of locals. It has also earned its place on the world sporting stage. When you grow up in Wangi, you learn to sail, and none did it better than Nathan Outridge and Ian Jensen, who won sailing gold medals in London and silver medals in Rio de Janeiro for Australia. A town with identities such as a journalist and author, Scott Bevan, entertainer, Francine Bell, and former Leyland brother Mike Leyland. Calling it or having called it home, Wangi remains an easygoing, egalitarian community. Wangi's working class roots are still reflected in the brick walls of the old Wangi power station, the biggest brick building in the country and the first power station ever built on a coalfield. It is a very proud community in a very beautiful town, and I am very proud to represent it. Happy birthday, Wangi Wangi. Well said. So I'll hand back to our MC, Murray.
And now would you welcome the man who made that speech in Parliament, our local member of the Legislative Assembly, Greg Piper.
Thank you, Murray. Thank you, Bruce, for reading that. That was a very quick 1 minute speech that we get to make in the Parliament, but I thought it was a very appropriate thing to do just to say a few words about this amazing community that we have here at Wangi Wangi. And it really is. It's an incredible township that was celebrating 100 years, but of course its history goes back beyond that. Scott, I didn't get to hear your talk this morning, but I'm sure that it was full of wonderful facts and anecdotes. And I've got a few of my own, but of course I can't say all of them because a lot of them came out of the Wangi Hotel. And because, you know, we know a lot of these things can't actually just be relayed in polite company or certainly mixed company. But one thing, I'm not sure I just if people know that much about it, but I just wanted to mention, I just mentioned to Scott and I was talking to Bruce about it earlier, about before the settlement came in and the place became a little bit more civilised, there's a lot of things that went on out here, and I'm sure if you're Wangi locals, you would have heard about the wonderful opportunities out here that with the shape of the peninsula, if you're a cattle duffer, because you could go out and you could steal people's cattle, you could run them out here on the Wangi Peninsula and take them out there and just let them go. It's fairly easy to maintain them out there. So the area was used by cattle duffers for a while. But I always liked the story about the Jewboy Gang, which was a very colourful group of highwaymen or bandits that roamed the Hunter Valley. They came through down here and, of course, as you would, they must have heard about the incredible wealth at Dora Creek Post Office. And they rode into Dora Creek. They wore beautiful costumes, military-style costumes with ribbons, and their horses were decorated in coloured ribbons. Apparently quite a sight to behold. But they robbed the post office and were pursued by the constabulary. They came out here to Wangi, where they were chased out. They went out onto the peninsula, and as you do, you escape by riding your horses off the peninsula out there at the Wangi Point and across to Swansea, where they made their escape good by heading then south down and up across from Somersby, I believe, and probably down through Wallumbye, stopped at the pub. I think the pub was open at Wallumbye Tavern then, and then went back up the valley before they got caught some months later. But we made plenty of our own characters around here. It's got quite a history, say with the industrial history, the power station, of course, the coal fields, coal mining, and many of those people who stayed on here to create the town. But it is an area that's made an extraordinary impact on the area, particularly with the sporting impact. Of course, the Wangi Sailing Club, an amazing icon, not just in Wangi, but around Lake Maquarie, of course, adopted very fondly by the state and by Australia whenever something big's happening, because Wangi Sailing Club has been there so much. But ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I am very proud to have an association with Wangi. Goes back quite some years. As a matter of fact, if it hadn't been for Wangi, I wouldn't have got involved in politics in the first place. So we won't talk about Reserve Road and all those things that happened in the early 90s. Okay, so I remember those times of mixed feelings. They certainly changed my life. And I'm sure that Wangi's provided a wonderful platform for the lives of so many Stanleys that are here today. I congratulate everybody that made the wise choice to come here. And I thank everybody that's involved in the community, because I don't think there'd be too many communities as strong as Wangi. And boy, you really know how to throw a celebration. So Mick and Bruce and to all the organising committee, everybody's got involved in this celebration. And whenever there's gold medals in the air, thank you very much for everything you do for Wangi. Thank you very much.
I have just given to Greg a device that will fit the set. The sailors won us gold and silver. Bruce has got the bronze. It's centenary medal number 100. He's going to place that in the time capsule, and that will be interred at Dobell House and to be opened in 100 years. So thanks, Greg, if you could place that inside the time capsule. Those of you who've seen that medal, it's a wonderfully crafted medal. Garth Chapman had a lot to do with its construction. We've sold the 100, and it's a wonderful memento for people who've been able to gain one of those. Our next remarks are from a former citizen of Wangi, a journalist, a musician, a raconteur. Some of us were serenaded by him on the Deck Cafe last night. Some of you have heard him speaking today. Would you welcome Mr. Scott Bevan?
Thanks very much, mate. I'm always worried when someone calls me a raconteur. I think that's a word for a larrikin who's just gone old. Can't I just be a larrikin? But maybe. How wonderful is it to be here today? Come on, we can do better than that. Imagine we're watching the Olympic gold sailing finals. Is it wonderful to be here today? Much better, much better. It's a place that neither my wife Jo nor I were born in, but when we came here in 1999, we came here to visit Dobell House, and a couple of days later we left with the house. We felt like we were starting a new life here, and we feel an enormous sense of not only being at home, being at ease here, we feel an immense sense of gratitude to this place, and that we owe a lot here. And we are certainly not the first to feel that way. I've just been taught some microphone technique up the back. Is that better? You'd reckon after 32 years I'd get that bit right. Oh, do you want me to look at this camera as well, mate, while I'm practicing? Now, the Awabakal, of course, were here many, many generations before any of us were here. Indeed, Awabakal means the people of the lake. And this place has even more significance, or equal significance. The water around here, of course, fed the people of the lake both spiritually and in a very physical sense. They were nourished by it, but in both terms. And of course, Wangi Wangi, in one translation, means the place of much water. The water was infused in the lives of the Awabakal, and it's been infused in our lives. And so many have been attracted here initially because of the water. Whether it was the workers from the coal fields coming down here for their holidays, through to those who bought blocks of land, bought off the Israels, who in their ads, you might have seen their old ads, it says, the popular watering place of Newcastle in district. Now imagine a popular watering place back then, ladies and gentlemen, before there was a watering hole. There was no pub. That pub didn't exist until 1955. So it says something about the enormous appeal of Wangi Wangi, that it could be a popular watering place without having a watering hole. So that was one benchmark of just how special this place is. And people came here, of course, to escape, whether it was to escape the working day of being in the pits. But probably the most famous person to escape is our best known resident, Sir William Dobell, Bill Dobell. In Sydney, they called him Sir William, because that's what he said down there. Up here, he wanted to be called Bill, and everyone called him Bill. And he said if anyone called him Sir William, he knew that they were having a lend of him. So up here, he was most assuredly Bill. And up here, he was among people he was comfortable with. He felt this was a good place to be. Because in coming here, Dobell wasn't thinking about painting anymore after the controversy of the 1943 Archibald Prize. And he wasn't thinking about high society or anything like that. He just wanted to be alone. He felt lost at that point in his life. But in Wangi, he found a few things he didn't imagine. For one thing, he found the desire to paint again. And as a result of finding that desire again, he went on to win not just another Archibald Prize in 1948. He also that year won the Wynne Prize for a landscape painting, which is called Storm Approaching Wangi, inspired by and depicting what he saw as he sat on his veranda down there a few hundred metres from where we're standing, watching the clouds scudding over the mountains and heading towards the bay, something all Wangiites know so well. So he not only found his desire to paint again, he found himself. He found the joy of life once more in this little lakeside village. And the reason he found those two things is because he found something here that he didn't encounter very much of in Sydney. He discovered a community. He found somewhere he could call home. Now, as Dobell discovered, all of us have discovered, this is a beautiful place geographically. You only have to look out there and see that, just how extraordinary it is. Because it's on a point, it feels barely connected to the rest of the world. And I still remember that feeling the first time Joey and I came here and walked down the street there, and it felt like we were in a country town, some 20 years behind. But it wasn't actually 20 years behind. Because of that feeling, it was light years ahead. It's part of what made this place special. But the natural beauty is not the only reason that all of us have fallen in love with Wangi, I suspect, for what makes this place so special.
What helped Bill Dobell find his way once more and has affected all of us here today is that sense of community. Because this place has what so much of the rest of the world doesn't have or has lost. That feeling of belonging, of people caring for one another, of wanting to help each other. They hold the knowledge here, you all hold the knowledge here, of the beauty of community. And yes, Wangi Wangi has million-dollar views, there's no doubt about that. But what price could you put on the value of its community and that sense of community? Bill knew that, Joe and I know that, all of you know that. So what we're celebrating today is not just the centenary of a village, we're celebrating the beauty of community and what it has done. What it has done for the past 100 years, what it does now, and what it will continue to do. So happy birthday, Wangi Wangi, and more power to you for the power of community. Thanks very much.
Thank you to Scott for those inspiring words, and we all know that what he said is
really, really true.
And let's hope the batteries aren't flattening. No, they're right. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the Mayor of Lake Maquarie City Council, Miss Kay Fraser.
Thank you very much, and I won't talk for very long because it is a bit cool. I just wanted to say happy birthday and how fantastic it is to be here. As I was driving here this morning, I turned to the Wangi, I thought, wow, all these people, they are just everywhere. Not close enough. As I was driving into Wangi this morning, I could see hundreds and hundreds of people lined across the road. Up there's a band up there playing further up, and there's just people everywhere. What a great sense of community. What a great bunch of people you are out here. We are so many out here today to celebrate 100 years. Absolutely fantastic. It shows a strong sense of community that you have here. It's absolutely amazing. I'm so chuffed to be here today. As you know, I'm the mayor. I've only been the mayor for been over 4 weeks, so it's just fantastic to be out here for this special occasion. And I was just thinking about Wangi yesterday, and I was thinking how unique and how special it is. It has a very long but a very interesting history. If we look back, and I know Scott touched on it, you know, the Wabakal people were out here, and we know that because we found Newtons out here, and why wouldn't they be here? What a great fishing spot. You know, they would have survived for many, many years out here because of the fabulous location of Wangi and the food source that would have been here for them. And then when we think about the Wangi power station, how important that was for the Wangi community and how that would have changed, you know, the people who lived here as well. I'd imagine that back then it would have been a lot of retirees, but when, you know, Wangi power station opened up, it would have been young families, would have been young kids living here. So what a diverse community, you know, it would have been back then as well. When we think about, you know, DK Israel, who had the ferry service running to Wangi, and all the shops that were opened up here, you know, back in the 1920s, 1930s, it would have been a bustling little society. And I was also thinking about the coal mines up in Cessna. I think Greg might have touched on that, you know, because they didn't get holiday pay. So what they would do is they would come to Wangi, they'd have 2 weeks off a year. Where would they spend their holidays? In Wangi. Why wouldn't you? It's absolutely wonderful. So what a great start for them and what a great thing for the Wangi community. So I'm really, really pleased to be here. And I didn't realise that I had some attachment to Wangi. My husband's auntie Iris, her name was Iris Hayes, and she was married to Matt Hayes, one of the people who actually started the fundraise to save Sir William Dobell's house. It was him and I think Linton, a woman by the name of Linton. There was a lot of people obviously involved in it, but there was a meeting set up not long after Sir William Dobell passed away. And they raised about £300 back then, but it took them like 6 or 8 months to do that. And they thought, how can we raise enough money to save this home? So Matt Hayes got involved, a few other people got involved, and they went to radio. And they raised all this money, and then they were able to get a loan. And thanks to them and the community, they saved Dobell House. So it's a great indictment of what the community can do. So thank you very much for having me along. I'm really pleased to be here. and I think I have to officially declare declare the centenary open. Thank you very much. But I don't have to jump in here, do I? Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Fraser. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd just like to call Mr. Garth Chapman forward. Where are you, Garth? And bring Margaret with you. Margaret, you're required down here, please. Margaret is from Lake Maquarie District Historical Society, and that is the two blue tent display behind where most of you are standing, with all of that wonderful original memorabilia about the original housing development for Wangi, which is the event we're celebrating today. And Garth just wants to make one gesture and say two words.
I'll try to feel the breath, but some people say this is very important to me. 2 years ago when we started to organise this event, the committee decided that we should have the history of Wangi, obviously, on the day. So I went into the Historical Society and met Margaret for the first time. And there she was, beavering away, mountains of photographs and historical facts about the whole of Lake Maquarie. And I said to Margaret, would you be so kind to do the Wangi centenary for Wangi? She looked at me and she said, I will. I said, wow, this is good. So over the next 2 years, I went and saw Margaret several times, and I looked at her face, and she's worked through all the bloody photographs and everything else, and she's getting a little bit anxious about it because there was so much to do. But anyway, she's finally done it, and she's categorised the history of Wangi there from the beginning of the 1880s right up until the 1920s. So I'd like to give her just much applause and appreciation for the work that she really has put into it. Thank you, Mark.
Indeed, well done. And there's been that amount of work done in all sorts of corners of the community, and it's all been on display in the various venues that we have. The entertainment this afternoon will continue, ladies and gentlemen. You can see setting up over here the students of Arcadia Vale Public School, and they're going to be playing for us for 30 minutes. That will be followed by a one-hour concert from Westlake Macquarie Concert Band, and then Lee Warren with his country music will entertain us from 2 o'clock until 3 o'clock. All the...
And then hang